Hey guys, it's Alan and Monique.
Hey, you finally said it.
I did the introduction, but it's not as good as when she does it. Guys, listen, we are here today with a fun topic, with a I think a necessary topic. But guys, we have heard from you guys. Thank you so much for all of the comments that you guys drop on the teasers that we do every Thursday.
Yeah.
Putting teasers out there to let you know that we have a new video out, and we always pick a part of the video to kind of throw on Facebook, and you guys show that so much love. Even on Instagram, you know, at Love On Purpose sees everything. So that's our official Instagram account together, and you guys again show so much love. But one of the reoccurring things that we always hear is, how do I find love like you guys have? Or, and basically, disclaimer, we're not perfect.
No, we are not perfect.
I get on Monique's nerves.
Whatever.
She never gets on my nerves.
Lies. I get on his nerves all the time.
A little bit sometimes, I think though, just that genuine love, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That genuine, I mean, like, we're still there. I call her all the time my ride or die. She's always in my corner, no matter what idea I have or no matter what kind of mood I'm in. She's always there, and vice versa for her.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we wanted to do today for our singles who are out there and they're like, how do I date effectively in this generation?
Yes.
In this day and time.
Yes, it is so hard.
How to date right now, this day and age, in this generation.
Yeah.
What do you think are some of the challenges? Think about it. Like, 2020,
yeah.
2021,
yeah.
Just like being a young person,
yeah.
So many Instagram, so many influences.
So I believe that some of the challenges that we face in this generation, our big thing comes from social media.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. I think that is probably our number one problem that we have with dating, because you can go on social media and one of the things is, we see women or we see men that have everything done.
Right. Literally.
Listen.
Literally though.
I mean, you can get everything done now. So it's kind of like the women that are, you know, not normal, whatever you want to call it. It's kind of hard for us because these men, they can go on social media and they see women with,
yeah,
large behinds,
mm-hmm,
large breasts, or whatever the case is. So they're not really interested in you, or you think they're not interested in you. Again,
right?
I think that's one of our big problems, and vice versa for women, mm-hmm, too. Women go on there, they see these men.
No, for real. Like, you got like the football players. Yeah. You got men who just are in the gym nonstop.
Yes.
You know, and I mean, these one in a million men.
Yes.
But then it's like, so hold on a second. You don't have $1.5 million in the bank?
Exactly.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, nope, can't talk to you.
Exactly. So that is probably one of the big issues that we deal with. Then we got this other thing that we deal with now, in our generation, women, you know, being entrepreneurial.
That's good.
The women really nowadays are killing it.
Yeah. No, for real.
I mean, women are out here literally killing it in entrepreneurship. And it's kind of intimidating to men.
Wow.
So it's hard for men to actually say, you know, I'm going to try to talk to this girl or whatever, because they're intimidated.
Wow.
Because they see this woman killing it in the game.
No, that's good. So, I mean, like, nah, fellas, and low key, I mean, you probably won't admit this, but you can relate, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's different approaching a young lady who is building, who's established. It's different approaching her than approaching someone who isn't, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Someone who isn't as involved in, you know, climbing the success ladder or whatever. It's just a different type of approach.
Yeah.
And I mean, if I'm honest, I would say that too. I think what gives us confidence in that is, again, knowing ourselves.
Yeah.
We talked about that on one other video.
Right.
But I think it's that, and then too though, and you got to speak to this a little bit. I think though, like, with some successful women,
they
don't make themselves as approachable.
No.
You know what I mean?
They don't. They really don't.
Speak on that a little bit. I mean, like, speak to the ladies on that a little bit.
So yeah, men look at it as intimidating, but women, we can be very intimidating. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, we can turn that around and say, if a man tries to come and talk to us, they got to have it all together. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, we could be, like I said, killing in the game with entrepreneurship or whatever. But when a man comes to try to hunt us, for say, it's like, if you don't have this in line, if you don't have 1.5 million in your bank account, right, if you're not driving this, if you got kids, I don't want to deal with you.
Yeah.
And we miss it. You know what I mean? We miss that whole dating aspect, and it's kind of like, it's hard for women,
yeah,
because we're looking for these things in a man, and it's, you know, it's a facade.
That's right.
I'm just saying, it's a facade. So.
You know what though? Like I remember, especially like, you know, way back in my singleness, like there were some young ladies that I would not like entertain in a conversation or, you know, dating or anything. If I sensed the fact that they were attracted to me because of the persona of me.
Right.
So I always said that. Like, I always said, you know, this particular person seems to be attracted to the persona of Alan.
Yeah.
So I mean, like, you know, like a young black brother who, you know, is not trying to talk to everybody, who is a bank manager,
yeah,
who you know, like you know, like they carry themselves well. So here's the thing though. So I was turned away, mm-hmm, from that, because what I realized through other relationships is that person wasn't as interested in the person of Alan,
right,
than they were the persona and the accomplishments of Alan.
Right.
So that turned me off. But on the same token, what I had to later realize though, especially after you and I started talking, is women are attracted to positive attributes.
Yeah.
And they should be.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, like, women should be attracted to positive attributes in a man. However, that shouldn't be the all in all though.
No.
Like, you know, because just like those, that list of accomplishments,
yeah,
you know, like man of God, like all of that list of accomplishments, you can say this now, it's like, along with that list of accomplishments, there's a list that's twice as long of imperfections.
Yeah.
And if you're not as involved in the person,
yeah,
then that list of accomplishments is going to get weaker and weaker to you as time goes on.
Yeah, definitely.
And so that would be one of my things right there, is just, you know, like, and this is for men and women.
Yeah.
This is for men and women. But I see it a lot with our sisters though.
Yeah.
I see it a lot, but I think it's because our sisters are working so hard now. They are earning some very, very, very prestigious you know, places in business, places in the world. I mean, like, they work hard for where they are. And I think they want to guard that,
yeah,
which is totally 100% true. But at the same time, there's this thing though, like, when you're looking for love,
yeah,
when you're looking for love, you still have, you said it earlier, you still have to be a person, a woman who is hunt worthy. You know,
yes,
what I mean? Like, I mean, like, because we talked about a man being a hunter,
yeah,
right? And so you still have to present yourself in a way that isn't so hard,
right,
to where the man's like, well, you know, like, it seems like it could be, but I'll, you know, I can't approach her.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about, like, creating that boundary line though. Because see, you could be too hunt worthy and everybody's hollering at you and you giving in to jokers who don't even, you know what I'm saying? So you could be too accessible.
Yeah.
But talk a little bit about how you handled being a woman who was building, who was, you know, like, creating this, you know, this whole life for herself. You had these goals and you were reaching the goals.
Mm-hmm.
So on one hand, you're a woman who's building, mm-hmm, but then on another hand, you're like, I know I'm not supposed to be single forever. I know I'm someone's wife.
Right.
Even before, you know,
right.
So on this hand you're building, on this hand, you know, you're still a eligible potential wife to some man out there.
Right.
How did you balance the two? So when I came along, you weren't so focused on one, on the business side, that you weren't approachable.
Got you. So how I handled that, in the beginning, like I said, I was working on me and working on my purpose. But I also had in my mind, like, I was becoming this woman who God wanted me to be. So I also had in my mind, like, I've never been married before. I've got two kids, you know. Not saying that I yearn for that life.
Yeah.
But I know that it wasn't just it. Like, yeah, for me to just have two children or whatever. So I kind of kept that mind open to where, you know, there may be a man out here who will at one point be my husband. I kept that open. So when he came around, I wasn't just closed-minded to, you know, if you're not part of what I got going on,
yeah,
it's not going to work.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I was open-minded to what he had going on, and I was open-minded to bringing him into my world. You know, when we had many conversations about that, just bringing him to see how he would fit into that, I was open to it.
Yeah.
A lot of times we as women, we're just like,
yeah,
we build up this wall where it's like, if you don't fit how this is supposed to look, then it's automatically off. But even, you know, with his flaws, I was still open,
yeah,
and willing to work around whatever we had to do, just because I know that God had more for me. You know what I mean? I know that God had more in store for me as far as like being married and having a family. So
another thing dating in this generation, like dating right now. So another thing is, how, with so many options, how do I stay committed to one woman?
Yeah, let's talk about that. So how? Because we want to know.
So listen, I mean, me and the fellas, I don't have too many friends that I hit up, text, whatever. But even the ones that I do have, sometimes it might come up in conversation, or it might just be extended people that I'm just kind of around. Maybe I'm in a barbershop, maybe whatever. But because my circle, they're kind of, you know, I mean, like, they're pretty tight or whatever. So they're pretty straightforward. But I mean, I hear and I have heard people struggle with this. Like, man, like, I know, I have a good woman, have a good wife. I have a good, you know, girlfriend or wife. But I just have a struggle with not talking to somebody else, or just only talking to her. And I know to women, I know, but you represent so many women viewers that are watching this right, yes, now. I know for women, that's a struggle to even hear and understand, like, what? Yes. Like, what do you mean? But if we're for real though, with the fellas, some fellas have a struggle with that. And I think they have a struggle with that because men, again, that hunt factor, right? Mm-hmm. So men were created to hunt. And listen, until that's tamed, you'll always struggle with that.
So how do you tame that?
So the taming process starts with yourself, right?
Mm-hmm.
It starts, you have to first know who you are. You have to know what you want, that kind of thing. You got to get control over yourself.
Okay.
But it doesn't end there. Right. I mean, like, it's still there.
Right.
But then after you find the one that's meant for you, then we have to, here's the thing. If I could say it in short, you have to make up your mind before you get in the situation that this is who I want and only who I want. So we're not, men and women alike, we're not strong enough to get in a tempted situation, to get in a hot situation where, and prime example, let's put it like this. It's a lady at the office. You guys, you know when she's kind of feeling you. Like, I mean, like, she doesn't have to send you an email, call you, whatever, or, you know, just tell you, hey, I'm into you. No, you know when she's kind of into you, right? You can't wait to get in a tempted situation with that person and then say, okay, I'm going to refrain myself. No, that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
You have to, that has to be premeditated. So whenever you are in your relationship, we talked a lot about building when we were in the first parts of our relationship. We talked about building a foundation.
Yeah.
Whenever you're building that foundation, you have to, like, be so invested in that person to where you say, listen, I'm putting all my chips in here, and then I commit myself to this person. Therefore, because there's going to be other attractive women.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not blind.
Right.
I see women who are attractive.
Right.
And that's going to happen.
Right.
So I think a lot of times people try to put those unrealistic,
yeah,
you know, barriers around themselves and say, oh man, like, I see you and only you. Lie. No, no. Listen, I see you. You're beautiful. But there's other beautiful women that the Lord has created as well, right? And so, but here's the thing. I'm not tempted by that, though, because I made up in my mind that I'm committed to my woman. Like this, like nobody can take her spot. I mean, I've been in situations where I felt a little ounce of something, and I'm like, and either through action or through word, I'm like, listen, no, this ain't happening. So we might as well go and cut that off right there where it's at. And it's important that we establish that early.
Yeah.
Because especially for guys, if you know, how are you gonna tell a lion? How are you gonna tell a lion? Think about any animal, a cheetah, think about any animal that's aggressive, right? A tiger. You're gonna tell a lion, listen, there's all this prey out here. You know, about a mile down the, you know what I'm saying? We're going down here and there's all this prey out here, but you can't go get any of it. No, you have to tame that lion.
Right.
Like that lion in some situations has to be secluded, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, like when you go to the zoo, what, they have their own cage, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why? It's been premeditated that this is what this lion's going to eat. This is what this lion's going to do.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to let him out there with the rest of the animals.
Yeah.
Guys are the same way. Mentally, we have to be committed to say, this is who I'm with. I'm in love with this person.
Yeah.
I'm committed to this person and I'm working on her. So I'm actively pursuing you. So I'm actively, you know, hunting you daily.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? I just didn't hunt you and didn't stop.
Right.
No, and you can attest. Yeah. Like, I'm always serving you.
Yeah.
I'm always trying to figure out how can I surprise you.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
But that's because the hunt's in me.
Right.
But I just have to channel and tame that hunt to be geared towards what's in my cage.
Gotcha.
What other challenges do you think? Do you think there are any other challenges?
Oh, yeah. So, I really feel like one of the big ones that we face is sex.
Yeah. Talk about it.
Yeah. Whenever you bring sex into the beginning of dating, it clouds what your plans is for the future.
No,
you know what
good.
I mean? Because whenever you start dating, you know, the goal is for you to get to know each other.
Mm-hmm.
That's the goal. The goal is for you to get to know who this character is, you know, what his future is, what his plans, I mean, all of that. But then when you throw sex into it,
yeah,
it's kind of like now you're emotionally attached. And I know for women, we get emotionally attached when it comes to sex. I don't know for men because I'm not a man. I'm sure it's some other stuff that happens. But we get emotionally attached. So now all of that goes out the window. The fact of I'm trying to get to know who this person is, I'm trying to learn what their future is. No, it's I'm emotionally attached now, so now I want to be with this person.
Yeah.
Just because now we had sex.
Wow.
And this is all I know. You know, if you start taking the sex away from me, then it's kind of like, what happened? You know what I mean? You start asking these questions. Look, wait a minute. What happened? Why are you not having sex with me?
Yeah, because there's no foundation.
It's no foundation. It's
That's
no
good.
Foundation. So I feel like sex clouds, you know, the dating part of a relationship.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
I mean, that's good. That's so good. Fellas, I know what you're saying. So I'll say it for you. It's hard. It is hard. It's worth it though.
Yeah.
So I'll say this. Now Monique can tell you, I was the weaker one in this area. She was the strong one. I was like,
but if people like looked in, they probably would say
vice versa, right?
Vice versa.
I was the strong one. And yeah. But I think though, because I wasn't as bad as I could have been.
Yeah.
And the reason is though, because I knew that it was gonna take more than that.
Yeah.
I knew that if I was serious about her, it was gonna take more than that. So I put a lot of time into building the foundation. And so like a lot of times people are like, man, like you guys are so engaged, you guys are so involved. But a lot of that came from that.
Yeah.
Because we said, okay, we can't allow our vision, God's plan for our life to be clouded by sex. We can't allow that to derail us.
Right.
And so we shifted that off and we began to build and work on foundation. And when we did that, we had something to fall back on.
Right.
Whenever things got a little rocky, things got a whatever. I'm talking about like whenever like we went through seasons where it might have been some miscommunication, misunderstanding. We were like, oh, this is the foundation. So this is what, and we had that to fall back on.
Yeah.
If we would have engaged in sex, especially sex at like very early in the relationship, there wouldn't have been any of that.
Yeah.
And so, my challenge is though, seriously though, fellas, like really consider that. So I mean, like when she's on that whole like, nah, like I think I want to wait. Like, man, you got a jewel. I mean, like if you have somebody who's like, nah, like let's wait until we get married. That's somebody who's gonna be there like for the long haul.
Yeah.
That's somebody who really cares about where y'all are going. Yeah. They really care about who you are and all that kind of stuff. So definitely take heed to that, and I would even say support that, because the relationship's gonna go way past that moment.
Oh yes. Oh yes. Way if you plan to be with somebody 50, 60, 70 years, it's got to be a makeup of more than just sex.
Yep.
Like seriously, like because when we get 60, 70 years old, sex is not gonna be a part of our, well, maybe, but I'm just saying, it's not going to be a major part of our lives, and we have to go back to that foundation. You know what I mean? Like what it was that I liked about you prior to sex.
Yeah, yeah. So I don't know about the 60 part. She's saying like a 60. I'm going to be. You know,
stiff. Nobody asked. Okay. Nobody asked. Nobody asked.
Oh man, I hope you guys have been taking some value from this though, for yeah. real, because I mean it is challenging dating in this generation in this time mm-hmm. with so many influences and everything. We've been thinking through how can we be more intentional with love on purpose. I mean, this is a message that you guys have told us we feel like as well needs to be out and really needs to be, you know, communicated, you know, globally.
Yeah.
And so pray with us as we think through, you know, the next steps for love on purpose. But guys, we have some great ideas
yeah.
and we think that it's going to be a blessing to you, a greater blessing to you. So whatever thoughts you have, topics you want to hear, drop them. Let us know.
See y'all next time.
See you next time.